Hello everyone, GoldenNova here. With Darkwing Blast recently being released in the OCG, we've got some new archetypes to fawn over, one of which being the latest addition to the Visas Starfrost storyline. So far, we've visited a world of fear populated by savage beasts and an ocean of sorrows. And now, it's time for our next step in our interplanetary tour across the world of emotions, the crushing feeling of hopelessness in the face of late-stage capitalism. That's right, instead of Visas exploring another realm, the big bads are taking the initiative and bringing the fight to our protagonist. And from what we can see in the art and their effects, Visas has their work cut out for him. We've also got some updates to Scareclaw and Tiara Laments that help flesh out the current story. So, without further ado, let's catch up with our bullied beasts and morose maidens to see what they're capable of now, explore the capabilities of these cunning colonizers, then see what other worlds they can exploit to bolster their holdings. It's time to captivate with Kshatri-La. But before we continue, a quick reminder to please like and subscribe if you've enjoyed my content so far. We're on the road to 100,000 subscribers, and there's no better way to get there than on our dual runners. Our next stop is 40k, which means Leo and Luna Explained, where we'll be covering Ancient Fairy Dragon's companions, the Power Tool Dragons, Morphtronics, and any other cards that are more than meets the eye. We've also got our Discord, where we now have even more proof that Phoenix Wright alumni Athena Sykes is best girl. I also have a Twitch where you can join me for viewer duels, progression polls, and chaos draft polls for the foreseeable future. And don't forget about my Patreon, where you can gain access to my videos early, reach some of these milestones, as well as helping to determine which videos I make. Thank you all so much for watching, and now, back to the video. Oh, actually, really quick, I've got some time codes down below, so if there's any particular archetype you want to get to right now, that's a good way to find them. Alright, let's catch up with Scareclaw, and while we're here, we might as well include all the Power of the Elements releases, since they didn't make their way into the TR Laments episode. And we've got one little scamp who I'm sure you've all fallen in love with, Scareclaw Lichtheart, a level 1 Dark Beast Warrior Link monster with 500 attack, requiring any Scareclaw monster or Visas Starfrost as material. But if you link summon this card, the material must be in the main monster zone, so no folding Triheart into this while in the EMZ, alright? And I guess no using another copy of Lichtheart there either. If this card is link summoned to the extra monster zone, you can add a primitive planet Reichphobia, the theme's field spell, from your deck to your hand. And if you control Visas Starfrost, you can special summon this card from your hand, but you can only use that last effect once per duel. The wonderful thing is that it doesn't trigger any kind of special summon lock, so you can use Lichtheart however you wish. But I'm sure what we're most excited for is that it's the link that searches the field spell,
the link that searches the field spell, the link that searches the field spell, the link that searches the field spell, the link that searches the field spell.
Scareclaw Straddle is a quick play spell that has you activating one of two effects. You can either target a Scareclaw monster or Visas Starfrost you control and a face-up monster your opponent controls, and your monster gains attack and defense equal to that monster's original attack or defense, whichever is higher. Your choices. Tide. Or, when a card or effect is activated that targets any number of your Scareclaw monsters or Visas Starfrost you control, you can negate that effect. It's an honest that can turn into targeted effect protection when you need it. The only drawback here is that you can only activate one per turn, because I'd want to play as many of these as possible. It also looks like we're getting a front row seat to how Visas travels between the planes, now being guided by a little chibi companion. Seriously, Konami! Plushies! Now! Okay, now it's time for some more current support. Decline Scareclaw is a normal spell that targets a primitive planet Reichphobia you control or that's in your grave, and on resolution, return it to your hand. Then, if you control Visas Starfrost, you can change a face-up monster your opponent controls to face-down defense position. And if three or more defense position monsters are on the field, you can banish this card from your grave to add a Scareclaw card from your grave to your hand. Being able to reuse your field spell is pretty choice, since it can search you more monsters of your theme. And while Book of Moon is a much stronger disruption tool when you can play it at quick effect speed, having it as a bonus effect to turn off a monster, and potentially make it weaker, is still pretty nice. The Grave effect is also neat, getting to recur any of your on-theme cards, but it can only be activated when there's a critical mass of defense position monsters on the field, so you've already kinda got your whole game plan by then, so it's not quite as useful. But if you need a little extra gas to close things out, I certainly wouldn't decline the help. Scareclaw Twinsaw is a normal trap card that tributes a Scareclaw monster to target two cards your opponent controls and destroy them. And if you control Visas Starfrost, banish him. And if a Link 3 or higher monster is on the field, you can banish this card from your grave, and neither player can activate the effects of Link monsters on the field this turn. Something that'll be really helpful against the new Zealantis, let me tell you. And since it's a trap card, you can spring this at any time. Just make sure you activate this before your opponent performs a Link summon. It stops activations, not effects. So if a Link has an on-summon effect like Nightmares, you won't be able to stop that if you wait until the summon is confirmed. And that's all really great without even touching on the on-field effect. It's basically Sword Soul Blackout, though you have to commit to the tribute as cost, so if it gets negated, you're still stuck holding the bag. But otherwise, it's solid removal that can banish if you've got the leading lad with you, and a little bit of anti-link utility that'll show up right twin time. That wraps up the Scareclaw cards, showing Visas' battle against the Kshatri-La. Now it's time to see it at another angle with Tiara Laments, and their new fusion monster, Lulacaris, a level 8 water aqua fusion monster with 3000 attack and 2500 defense, requiring Tiara Laments Chattacaris, one of our previous fusions, and any of our other Tiara Laments as material. While on the field, your other aqua monsters can't be destroyed by battle, forcing your opponent to remove them by effect, which is just fine by me. When your opponent activates a card or effect that includes special summoning any number of monsters as a quick effect, you can negate the activation, and if you do, destroy that card. Then send a Tiara Laments card from your hand or face-up on the field to the grave. And if this fusion summoned card is sent to the grave by a card effect, you can special summon this card. So you get to use Lulacaris for free for one of your Tiara Laments effects, including her own anti-special summoning effect. And the wording here is a very important distinction, as it stops effects that special summon, but not anything like a Link or a Synchro summon. And because the battle destruction protection extends to all Aquas, this has some great overlap with Frogs. Land a totally awesome on board, whether by Frogs or by Bahamut Shark, pair them with this Tiara Lament, and you won't have a Lulacaris in the world. Tiara Lament's Grief is a normal spell that can special summon a Tiara Lament's monster or Visas Starfrost from your deck or grave, and if you do, send a monster you control with the same type or attribute to the grave. And if this card is sent to the grave by a card effect, you can target one of your banished Tiara Lament trap cards and add it to your hand, but you can only use one effect per turn, and only once per turn. Now, this might not look like it, but this is actually a pretty effective Foolish Burial. After all, it doesn't say you can't send the monster you summoned. Sure, you can summon something and then keep it on the field by sending another monster to the grave, but when all of your Tiara Laments trigger when sent to the grave by a card effect, why wait? Well, I guess you'd want to wait until you have a grave with enough material in it to fusion summon, but that's a whole other deal. Alternatively, because it can send any monster with a matching type or attribute, you can send a light, dark, water, aqua, or warrior monster, so if you need to vent another monster from your board and it's one of those five parameters, this spell has you covered. And that's a pretty good spread of characteristics if I do say so myself. Good grief. Tiara Lament Heartbeats is a quick play spell that targets a spell or trap card on the field, or up to two instead if you control Visas Starfrost, and shuffle them into the deck. Then send a card from your hand to the grave. And if this card is sent to the grave by a card effect, you can target a Tiara Laments trap card in your grave and add it to your hand. And you can only use one effect per turn, and only once per turn. Damn, shuffle into the deck, that's a great way to get rid of a card. It's only an even trade if you control Visas, but since you can send any card from your hand to the grave, you can trigger your Tiara Laments spell and trap effects to get some value. And because it's a quick play spell, it can be used as interruption as well. Heck, this just might power creep Cosmic Cyclone given the right deck. You could say it heart beats out the competition. Tiara Laments Scream is a continuous spell, and if any number of monsters are normal or special summoned and you control a Tiara Laments monster or Visas Starfrost, you can send the top 3 cards of your deck to the grave. Also, all face-up monsters your opponent controls lose 500 attack for the rest of the turn. And if this card is sent to the grave by a card effect, you can add a Tiara Laments trap card from your deck to your hand. This is probably one of our more situational cards, though it can trigger on our own normal and special summons, so it's not entirely without value. Especially because 500 attack can be just what it takes to get over a big monster. Honestly, it has more value as a card you can pitch off your Tiara Laments effects to grab an onboard monster negate, an Omni negate, or a Book of Moon type effect. But when it comes to Scream, and I don't care if you shout, I'm gonna let it all out, this is one of the cards I could do without. Come on. And with that, we're all caught up with Scareclaw and Tiara Laments. So, with that out of the way, what's the deal with Kshatri-La? Well, they're a series of level 7 psychic monsters with a variety of attributes, and they can all be special summoned from the hand, provided you control no monsters, have an ignition effect you can use during your main phase to add a certain kind of Kshatri-La card from your deck to your hand, and a trigger effect you can use when that monster attacks, or when your opponent activates a monster effect. And guess what? That's about to become very lore relevant very soon. But no matter what, it takes some of your opponent's monsters and banishes them face down, so you're going to be stripping away a lot of their resources. As for the name, the Yugipedia article denotes that as a portmanteau of the words Shangri-La, Ira, the Latin word for anger, and Kshatriya, and that is what I find the most interesting, as the Kshatriya are one of the four Varna, or social orders, in the Hindu caste system. Something my research has shown has been abolished for decades, but as large institutions made to consolidate power tend to do, have had long-reaching consequences after their removal, even today. The Kshatriya sat at the second highest level of the hierarchy, acting as the warrior caste, so I wouldn't be surprised if the Kshatri-La were working on behalf of another archetype, and in the next set, we'll see their bosses associated with the highest caste, the Brahmins. Let's start by talking about someone we've already had the displeasure of meeting before, Kshatri-La Unicorn, a wind monster with 2500 attack and 2100 defense, and during your main phase, it can add a Kshatri-La spell card from your deck to your hand. And if Unicorn attacks, or when your opponent activates a monster effect, you can look through your opponent's extra deck and banish a card from it face down. Yeah, Dogmaticas have to jump through a million hoops to access your opponent's extra deck, but Unicorn can look at it in response to its search effect being ashed. And that's the real danger of dealing with this theme. Hand traps are the primary way of interacting with your opponent, and many of the best are monsters. That gives the Kshatri-La a kind of true Draco quality, where trying to stop them gets you punished even more. Stopping the Kshatri-La, or even advancing your own game plan, gets you a one-way ticket to a useless extra deck, because they get to surgically extract the best card from it. You know, between this, Nightmare Unicorn, and Cabin in the Woods, I'm starting to think those mythical creatures aren't as pure as we've all been led to believe. Kshatri-La Ogre is a water monster with 2800 attack and 1000 defense. Ooh, Mega Monarch stats! During your main phase, Ogre can search you a Kshatri-La trap card from your deck to your hand, and when this card attacks, or your opponent activates a monster effect, you can excavate the top 5 cards of your opponent's deck, and if you do, banish one of them face down. Also, place the rest of those cards on top of the deck in the same order. So you don't get to mess with your opponent's top deck, but you will get to know what it is, on top of taking away your opponent's best card out of those top 5. Now, outside of just knowing what your opponent's next few top decks are going to be, you don't really have any way to take advantage of that information. But that doesn't mean you can't splash in anything that can. For instance, spirals just love knowing this stuff, and the two themes don't exactly clash, so it might be worth it to consider adding these spies to your family. Kshatri-La Fenrir is an earth monster with 2400 attack and defense, and during your main phase, you can add a Kshatri-La monster from your deck to your hand. And if this card attacks, or your opponent activates a monster effect, you can target a face-up card your opponent controls and banish it face down. Now, if the Kshatri-La player is going first, this probably isn't going to deter much, since your opponent's field doesn't, exist. But in most other phases of the game, this can be ruthlessly punishing. It does target, so there is some protection against it, but that's the only protection that will keep them safe. Anything else will get them dumpstered easy. And Fenrir searches you all the rest of your Kshatri-La monsters. This might seem counterintuitive, since they're all level 7 and their special summon effect requires you to control no monsters, but trust me, there's a way around that built right into the theme, so Fenrir here is anything but a lone wolf. The last Kshatri-La monster is currently their only extra deck representative, and despite the stat line, is probably the most frightening. Kshatri-La Shangri-La is a rank 7 Fire Xyz monster with 0 attack and 3000 defense, requiring 2 or more level 7 monsters as material. During the standby phase, you can special summon a Kshatri-La monster from your deck, and it doesn't say your standby phase, the standby phase, so you'll be turboing out these mythic meatheads pretty quickly, though thankfully it is a hard once per turn, so this effect doesn't stack across multiple copies. However, the next one does. Each time any number of your opponent's cards are banished face down, you can choose an unused main monster zone or spell and trap zone, and it can't be used while this monster is on the field. And if this card on the field would be destroyed by a battle or card effect, you can detach a material from it instead. So the more material you put under Shangri-La, the more shields it has to resist destruction. And considering its 3,000 defense points, that's no small order. But what's wild is its ability to lock out zones. It isn't once per turn, and while removing Shangri-La gives you back all your zones, it's gotta be by bouncing or shuffling back into the deck. Every other form of removal is gonna be like trying to chew through gristle. And not only can this trigger off of our Kshatri-La main deck monsters, it also triggers when our opponent banishes cards face down. So if they're running any of the modern pot of cards, they're gonna have a very important decision to make. They can't just activate it all la-dee-da. Kshatri-La Birth is a continuous spell that lets you normal summon a level 7 monster without tribute once per turn, which covers all of our on-theme monsters, as well as any other level 7s you'd like to tech in. During your main phase, you can special summon a non-Xyz Kshatri-La monster that is banished or is in your grave. And if your opponent activates a spell card or effect and you control a Kshatri-La monster, you can target 3 cards in your opponent's grave and banish them face down. So it's not just our monsters that are filling up the banished pile. Birth is an incredible piece of tech, because on an open board, you can special summon one from your hand for free, normal summon another, then grab one out of your grave, and each one gets you a search effect, provided they're all different Kshatri-La so their once per turns don't conflict. Then you'll have plenty of attacks to banish even more of your opponent's cards, before folding them into a Shangri-La and solidifying your advantage. This is a truly oppressive card, but considering the aesthetics, I wouldn't expect anything less from the most tyrannical of classes, gamers. Kshatri-La Prepare is a continuous trap card, and during either player's turn, you can special summon one of your Kshatri-La monsters that are banished or are in your hand. And if your opponent activates a trap card or effect while this card is already face up in the spell and trap zone, and you control a Kshatri-La monster, you can look at your opponent's hand and banish one card from it face down. So for anyone who thought they could run Infinite Impermanence as a way to prevent the monsters from punishing you, then you better think again. After all, this is an interplanetary smuggling slash mining slash overall evil doing organization. Of course they're gonna come prepared. With all their cards out of the way, normally we'd move on to tech picks, but for this theme, I'd like to take a little extra time to talk about the lore and what's going on here. First, a bit of an addendum. Last time, when talking about Tiara Laments, I was under the assumption that Kaleido Heart was under the control of one of the Tiara Laments, probably a member of the ruling elite. This somber figure behind Kaleido Heart in their art was my primary reasoning, with the art for crime possibly showing a stricter form of control. However, I think it's pretty clear now that I was incorrect, as that's not just any old Tiara Lament, that's Chatakaris, and it looks like they're stabbing Kaleido in the back while Visas is drawing aggro. I believe this leads us to the art in Tiara Lament's Grief, where Kaleido is fading away, and the cosmic wisps of their power are being given to both Visas and Chatakaris, which in turn fuels their evolution into Lulakaris. In the art for Tiara Lament's Heartbeats, we can see Visas siphoning even more power from Kaleido, but we see two figures descending from above. And those sharp spines don't look like other Tiara Laments, those look like Kshatri-La. But it looks like Peril Reino isn't the place where they'll be duking it out, because Tiara Lament's Scream shows Unicorn going toe-to-toe against Lulakaris, with three comets arcing off in the distance. Now, the last time we saw this was in the art for Peril Reino, but that was only one comet, even though it was Visas and Lichtheart. If I had to guess, I'd say that the light blue one is actually Visas, lining up with the color of their comet that we've seen them in previously, with the other two being the other Kshatri-La as Visas makes their pursuit. Lulakaris looks to stave off Unicorn, but that's where the art for Kshatri-La Prepare comes in. See, that canister it's holding shows up a lot in the Kshatri-La art, but we haven't seen the contents until now. It's very fuzzy at the moment, but considering we're looking at Unicorn, and the person inside looks to have long, wavy hair, I'd bet dollars to donuts that that's Lulakaris, having lost in battle against Unicorn, and is now being hauled back to the Kshatri-La's Birth, which is kind of like a port, for processing. And I wouldn't be surprised if the other canisters were likewise all filled with captives. In the background, we have a figure surrounded in a red aura. I think looks like Visas in a way, but like reversed, the armored arm being on the left rather than the right. So I'm thinking this might be a member of the Brahmin class I mentioned earlier in the video, which could mean that Visas is a member of their clan, looking to right the wrongs of their civilization. In fact, if I might push the boundaries of speculation here just a bit, the caste below, the Kshatriya, is the Vaishya. And if you smush the syllables together, Vaishya sounds kinda like Visas, just enough for it to be a reference without being the actual name, kind of like how Kshatri-La is meant to evoke the Kshatriya. But this is where my ignorance is probably having me leaping at shadows based on English translations, and a broad ignorance of actual Hindu culture. If anyone in the audience has more knowledge about Hindu culture, I'd love to hear your thoughts on my conjecture, any information that could clear this up, and even your own theories, because I really dig this stuff. Another quick thing I'd like to point out is how clearly the idea of the Kshatri-La stripping other worlds of resources translates to game mechanics. Each time they banish a card face down, it's always from some place that's kind of a resource. The grave, hand, field, extra deck, nothing is safe from their reaching talons. And it works whether you passively let them attack, or when you resist as a kind of retaliation. Though, really, if you retaliate, you at least have some chance of beating them. But if you give up letting them pick apart your cards and even the field you use, then you're doomed to extinction. True, the deck doesn't actually take anything, it just banishes cards face down, but A, if you were able to steal cards on this level, this theme would be even more broken than it already is, and B, I'd even go so far as to say that that's even more flavorful, because it's their actual effects that search Kshatri-La monsters and revive them that's the actual product. The cards being banished face down, those are the wasted resources after being used up. Even graveyard cards could be used for something, but being banished face down is as poisoned and unusable as it gets. Thankfully, Visas is on the scene, ready to deal some damage to the Kshatri-La, so while they're busy, let's find out what you do with them. And really, I think it's pretty evident that you want to go aggro. You have a lot of cards that punish your opponent, but you also strip them of cards when attacking, so you want to be doing that a lot. All the while, we'll supplement our small monster base with spells and traps that get us our big monsters, utilizing them to clear the way for a swift victory. But what can we play to help them out? Well, both birth and prepare summon banished Kshatri-La, but we don't really have any of our own banishing synergies. While there's no doubt that something like that is coming down the pipeline in later sets, why wait? Let's go ahead and use Sacred Sword of Seven Stars as a draw engine. Once they're banished, we can just summon them right back with our aforementioned back row while grabbing two fresh cards. Level 7 is one of the more difficult non-tuners to work with, but the payoff is extraordinary. Considering how easy they are to summon here, the deck is almost begging you to run a full suite of hand traps, because normal summoning Valor gets you level 8 synchro access, while normal summoning Ash gets you level 10 access. Anybody else looking for a free negate with Barone? Or perhaps a more banishing with Sword Soul Sovereign?
Why not also consider using a hand trap like Heavenly Zephyr Miradoro when going second to stop your opponent from being able to use key monsters like their Destroyer Phoenix Enforcers or any important extra deck monsters with over 2,000 attack points, and then during your turn being able to use Kshatri-La Birth to convert one of your Kshatri-Las in hand with your Heavenly Zephyr Miradoro straight into a Shangri-La to get your plays right off the bat.
Heck, why even waste your normal summon? Punks have been going really strong since their latest wave of support, and with E-Telly, you can grab a little plus one before going into your synchros. Heck, since we want to be special summoning so much, there's no reason not to play the Adventure Engine. Even if you normal summon a Kshatri-La via Birth's effect, you can just choose not to activate its effects. And in return, you get a negate and a way to clear a card once per turn. We've also got rank 7s to consider. Dracosac and Big Eye are classics, but we can also invest in Red Eye's Flare Metal Dragon. Masquerade shouldn't be hogging all the fun of taxing effects, right? But a card I feel was made for this deck, if not for the fact that it was released a while ago, was number 89 Diablosis the Mind Hacker. It banishes cards from your opponent's extra deck and grave face down, and can banish mill your opponent's deck face down equal to the number of face down banished cards they already have, which can get really out of hand really quickly. It's almost like a second win condition. A third win condition if you count Shangri-La's Lockout. Or as I like to call it, Shangri-Lockout. As for a silly tech pick, how about Piercing the Darkness? Sure, it'll require you to run some high-level normal monsters, and Red Eye's Black Dragon is just the pick. With Birth, we can normal summon them without issue, and if used as Xyz material, or heck, even as Synchro material, all the stuff we said before works just as well, and that monster you make benefits from the Honest effect. And if you make Flare Metal Dragon, you can just summon back the Red Eyes so you can do it again. And that's all I've got to say about Kshatri-La. I expect they'll make a big splash in the competitive scene, as they seem to splash into a lot, can search their relatively small engine very easily, and pack a lot of punishing effects. But if you use them, you are admitting to furthering the agenda of Capital, so you're going right into the morally incorrect archetype's jail alongside S-Force. But now, I want to hear what you all have to say. Are Kshatri-La your new lucky number 7? Or does Vsauce's 6 levels make it unlucky number 13? Let me know in the comments, and if you haven't already, please make sure to like this video and subscribe to show your support, ring that bell so you don't miss an episode, and share this video with someone you know who loves Yu-Gi-Oh! It really does a lot to help me out. Today's episode was brought to you by my lovely patrons, including this month's illustrious Quasar Commander, Ashling Waltz, Nebula Navigators, Third Dynasty, Avagule, Adam Zajdel, Avi Chali, Cryptic Gamer, Eric, Frankie, Genesis Yu-Gi-Oh, Gloomba 331, Great Big Pillock, Howling Zangetsu, Inblink, Ironic, John Manji, Julius Sneezer, Larakia, Meteornis, Mighty Action X, Panther J, Rebel King Lucifer, Ruxith Sarani, The Fresh Prince of Con Air, The Wizard Moose, Tyler Cranston and Xander Wolfensberger, Cosmic Crusaders, Bear Sharktopus Studios, Chaz Ghost, Corbinisms, Cozyboat 275, Harry the Ominous Benefactor, Jesus Garcia, Manga Pages, Marion James E. Picada, Nitromo, RGS, Rem T. Bright, Shooting Star 3300, Star Lord 777, and the Legendary Raven, as well as the wonderful Starlight Explorers you see on screen now. I'm only able to continue doing this thanks to the support of these lovely people, so if you'd like to be a part of these credits, as well as help me in my journey to cover all of Yu-Gi-Oh!'s archetypes, please check out my YouTube membership or Patreon links in the description to see if I have anything you'd like on offer. And if you'd like to see this new saga of card lore from the beginning, check out this video I made covering Scareclaws. And if you want to see two Yugi-tubers going at it, check out Noah Jenk and I's latest series progression polls, where your voice shapes the format. Thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.